think that you're taking up some new initiative, like the heart to heart initiative, etc. This is a very good move, and I do hope your successor will maintain the same progress in terms of these various programs. Well, heart, ladies and gentlemen, is central to every sensitive field of medicine is concerned. All that I can say is, one thing that has baffled like an ignorant person like me is, what exactly is a causative factor for a heart ailment or for a cardiac disease? Sometimes people say weight, sometimes people say lifestyle, sometimes some people say stress management, somebody says dietic disorders, somebody says genetic disorders. We really don't know what the real cause is. I do hope this conference will throw up something on, sort of giving us this knowledge of what really causes. I know your answer will be that there can be no single cause. All these causes, either individually or jointly, can always cause a cardiac problem. Maybe stress levels have increased, and so there are more cardiac cases coming to hospital these days because we are not able to manage our stress levels. Or you can say dietary habits have changed so radically that people taking the wrong type of food, and so they come to hospitals. Genetic disorders, I think, is a very recent phenomenon, because in the past, probably many of our elders must have passed away due to various cardiac problems, not even realizing there's a cardiac problem. So now, when we go to a doctor, probably he asks the family history and then says that probably you have a genetic disorder or whatever it is. But I think there must be something by which we're able to identify what really causes this cardiac problem first, and how do we manage it. Today, I'm afraid what may be the initiative that you may be talking in terms of, I find the emphasis is more on the curative part of it than the preventive part of it. I was happy to hear Dr. Sunil Kumar said that there is a lot of awareness thanks to the media. I'm afraid I beg to disagree with you, Doctor, on this. I think the awareness is still minimal among the population as to at what point of time you go in for medical consultation. Sometimes it is taken as a gastric problem and sometimes it's taken as a heart problem. So people may get confused between a gastric problem and a cardiac problem. There's nothing much to worry about. Or sometimes people are very sensitive, they start sweating a little bit, they go off to rush off to a doctor and think that they had a heart attack. And I think the very thought that you had a cardiac problem gives you a cardiac problem more than the actual problem. In fact, it's a thought. So I think what you need to really probably treat is more the mind than the heart in many cases. Unfortunately, I think there's a psychological trauma that society is going on today. That you go to anybody, you say, no, don't stress yourself, they say it will cause you a cardiac problem. I think we need to address this mind sensitive to the people and say it is not something to get so frightened about or get so psyched about. I think today, doctor, let me tell you that the average man is almost getting psyched by this heart problem. Because when you see somebody, and again age, again I find it has no relevance to age. Some people say that, you know, 40 plus is the most, 40 to 50 is the most dangerous age. Somebody about 60 gets it, no, 60 is the most dangerous because at the time when your activity levels come down to minimal and so thereafter the inactivity causes you. So for everything we have an excuse. But what really causes this problem is a question that I would like to raise before this extremely knowledgeable audience. Well, you could also say ill effects of smoking, tobacco consumption, whatever it is. But what happens to non-smokers? Of course, we have an excuse, passive smokers. That's the straight answer that one would give it. But what happens to non-smokers? Why do they get heart attack? What happens to people who are so calm, who say, who don't have any stressful life at all? Why do they get a heart attack? What happens to somebody who has a very good diet, very rigid, very clear diet, very comfortable timings in terms of sleep, get up, exercise, what you may call, why does he suffer a heart attack? I'm sure there must be answers. Actually, I'm probably more as an ignorant person, as I told you, I want to sort of confess my ignorance and say that this is something which you doctors will have to make it public as to what really causes and how can we prevent it. What are the preventive measures? Are we able to talk more of preventive measures? Because curative is part of your profession, but I think preventive is part of your social responsibility. How far are we fulfilling the societal responsibility of preventing a cardiac arrest, a cardiac problem, and teaching people how to manage various causes that might bring about a cardiac situation? How far are we doing? The other thing that I would like to raise is my popular theme is how could we make medical consultations affordable to the common man? How far is it within the reach of a common man? or if a man has a heart problem, is he going to die out of heart attack because the very cause that is going to be involved in treating? How do you do that? I have a very, very foolish suggestion, a very rustic suggestion to sort of put forth before this August House of Consideration. Like in the case of paddy procurement, we have what is called the minimum support price, the MSP, which is based on various factors like what is the cost of production for the farmer, various inputs, power, fertilizers, seeds, soil condition, tilling, etc. Calculate all that and then fix this minimum support price plus add on a little amount of profit which he has to naturally get. Could we do something like that in case of cardiac? What exactly is your minimum cost? And after that, can we add on a little bit and make that the cost of a cardiac intervention? I know it's a very, very stupid suggestion to make, and many of you laugh it away after I go, or probably you laugh it away straight away. But I can tell you, doctors, it is today unaffordable for a common man. It is just not possible to pay for a cardiac intervention. It is mighty expensive. Why is it so expensive? You will say, yes, gadgets are expensive, but I said, suppose you can always recover the cost of gadgets. It's not in 5 years, probably it's going to take 10 years. But you'll recover it. You'll never run at a loss. Is there a need to make medical treatment so expensive as it is today? What are we going to do for that? So fine, discussing all these conferences, may all discuss various useful suggestions on how to treat, how to do, etc. But can this conference come up with some factor on how do we really reduce cost? And can you sort of make it commonly applicable to all cardiologists all over this country? Or at least can the AP chapter take an initiative on this and say that we will not charge more than this for a cardiac disease? How are we going to do this? You may say Aarogyashree program. You may say various excuses might be given. Saying an Aarogyashree, sir, you give us 50,000, it's going to cost me 1,25,000. I'm still subsidizing the 70,000. I want you to work it out actual needs. Go to the breakdown and say what is the minimum cost of a cardiac intervention. Take everything that you have, your gadgets, your nurses, your sisters, your doctors, and everything. Put together and say how is it. And thereafter comes the next question is the hospitalization. How affordable is hospitalization? You can say, don't go into a special room, go into a common room, and then it will be less expensive. That's a very easy way of putting it. That's a very, very simplest way of putting it. It hurts only when the shoe bell, the only when the wearer of the shoe knows where it pinches. It's all very easy for us to say it from the podium. How do we make medicines more affordable? Why don't we go for generic medicines? Why are all the time going only for branded medicines and generic medicines can do the same thing, as I'm told? Today I have no idea of this. But various doctors tell me the generic medicines have the same effect as the so-called branded medicines. But why is it that we never go for branded medicines, we always go for generic medicines? Why is it that we always go only for branded medicines and not for generic medicines? Why? Why are pushing up the cost of the patient? By all these things, the various tests, can we make the test a little less expensive than what it is? Again, I know you will say the cost of equipment, but how much is the cost of equipment going to be, sir? As I told you, the recovery period, if it's going to be 5 years, probably it'll become 10 years. It'll just get doubled. And any of the hospital that you run or the clinic that you run are going to last for probably centuries, if not 50 or 60 years. So you'll recover it. Probably the profit may not be as fast as you are hoping to plunge into it. So I think these are issues which I think this conference should really look at. More than many of the discussions, of course, the knowledge discussions are a must be updating, and knowledge is an absolutely essential thing. But how do I really make this affordable to the common man, to the average man? I'm not the treatment. But tomorrow when I attend the office, I'm a common man, I'm a middle class man, I cannot afford this sort of treatment that you people are talking about. That is the fate of a common, of a middle class man today. What are you going to do for him? How long will we carry on like this, charging such high fees for medical treatment? I think the stage has come where we really have to see how something. I would be very happy to hear from you on this, say in the next course of the next 90 days as to what exactly have you done to reduce costs and how have you made this as part of your code of ethics. Do we have an ethics for the profession? And if so, can you sort of bring this as part of your code of ethics, saying that no hospital, nobody will charge more than this for the following cardiac interventions? It can definitely be computed. Don't tell me it cannot be computed. And why don't we go for generic medicines? Why don't we go for lessening even your soldier various tests that have been conducted for? Starting from the X-ray to this thing, gamma ray and gamma ray and whatever ray it may be. But ultimately, what happens? I mean, the man has to survive after the treatment, but the enormous cost that he's incurred will probably make his life impossible for him. You would rather prefer to die than live because the debts that you have incurred in getting himself treated. I know many of you must be angry at the decision that I am taking. I could see that. But I mean this, and I think it's happening. The time has come when I think we need to call shots. We need to do some hard talk. I mean, there's no use of glossing over things and all the time patting ourselves on the back and saying this is what it is and this is what it is. Then service in the rural areas. How far are we able to spread? How far are we able to go into the rural areas? In fact, I have been suggesting for a long time, which of course has not fructified over the last 2 years, I don't think it will ever fructify, is that I said, can a group of corporate hospitals get together, identify, say, half a dozen killer ailments, which, you know, will kill a person, or which is going to be very expensive treatment, and start a group of people, go to, take up one district as a pilot project, and screen the people of that, screen the population of that district, to see whether any one of them is suffering from any of the ailments, advise them and go in for preventive care or in the initial care, curative care itself, rather than it's coming to you at the last stage. I don't think this is happening at all because people are not interested. People don't want to do it. 2 years now I have been speaking to all the corporate hospitals in Hyderabad. Nothing has happened so far. You may say, sir, we have a segment which is kept for the people in our hospitals. We do this for the people, we do this for the people. Everybody does everything for the people. But the bills, the medical bills for the government is also increasing. Why? If all of you are doing so much of free treatment, why is my medical bill, why is my artificial bill going up by heaps and pounds every year? You can say ailments are increasing. Why are ailments increasing? Then why don't people do this as a pilot project as part of a corporate social responsibility? Take up a pilot project in a district and try and screen the population for at least about half a dozen killer ailments, which you think people are totally ignorant about. There are some hospitals that have started this. I find one of the eye hospitals that started this in the rural areas. They go and test everybody, they teach the preliminary tests are done, then they teach people how to do the preliminary test, train them, and then if there's a requirement, they bring them to the next stage of care, and then take them out to the next care of care. Why don't we do this in terms of at least six major killer ailments? Every time I make this point, everybody says it's an excellent point, so we will do it, but nothing happens. Nothing has happened in the last 2 years that I've been a governor. Why? I mean, I think it's time that we really put our heads together and see whether we have a societal responsibility or not. I think every one of us has a societal responsibility. There is no use of blaming only the government for everything and put everything on the government's neck saying it is the government's responsibility. If you take that everything is a government responsibility, then private hospitals have no place in this society. Corporate hospitals have no place in society if you think that it is only a government responsibility. I think we are doing a public-private partnership with the government, with the private hospitals. So I expect the corporate hospitals will come forward and give us solutions to these problems. Take an initiative. Do it in a pilot project in one district to start with. Why can't you do it in one district at least? What is the problem? I'm sure you can spare half a dozen doctors at least 1 week in a month who can go and do a screening and come back. It will probably take years and years. It will probably take the next century before you screen the entire population of Andhra Pradesh. But at least there will be a certain amount of sense of confidence in the mind of the people that rural people also have medical facilities available to them. Doctors today are not willing to go and serve in the rural areas. Why? Nobody is willing to serve in a rural area. Why?